हाय दमन, गुड आफ्टरनून।
गुड आफ्टरनून।
Hi Taman, very good afternoon and thank you so much for joining us today. Really great to have you join us for the next 1 hour. We earlier had the founding dean of ISB also join us.
Oh, that's nice.
So you're just mentioning to him that our alum of ISB is hosting, being hosted in the afternoon as well. So before we get started on the exciting journey and vote, just wanted to introduce you and your experience as well, and then we can get started with some of the questions we had in mind regarding the amazing growth you've driven for multiple brands, and then we can open it up for Q&A at the end of the session. So just to introduce Daman, I think a lot of experience, but to summarize, I think he started his career at NIT Roorkela. He completed his electrical engineering and then went on to ISB in 2004-2005 to finish his MBA. After that, he joined Infosys, one of the bellwether stocks as well, spent some time in Europe, including the UK and Ireland. And post that, actually started up as an entrepreneur with two ventures, Concept Gears, which was in the education space. And Daman, it would be great to hear more about that from you, as well as Planet Gogo, which was a personalized news platform. And post that, he went on to become the CMO at multiple startups, including MobiQuick, Milk Basket. And after that, he's been helping drive growth at White Hat Junior as well, which has obviously been in the news for the amazing growth journey, which they went from 0 to 150 million run rate in a span of 18 months. So it'll be great, Daman, to get some insights on the secret sauce in such hyper growth as well. And over the last year or so, Daman joined Boat as VP of Growth to really drive growth for one of the leading brands in the electronic space. It's really become a lifestyle statement, creating the Boathead community. And Daman's been driving both the brand side as well as on driving results from direct to e-commerce. And we've had the privilege of working with him. I think our teams really enjoyed working with Daman. He's really a leader who likes to inspire and teach and not manage. And I think the team also really, including Tej, who's co-moderating the session with me. We really enjoy working with Daman for the energy and perspective which he brings in terms of insights. And that's why we were really delighted to have him as a speaker today to share his insights. Daman, I don't know if I've got anything wrong over there, but very warm welcome to you again.
Thanks, yeah. Thanks. Lovely to be here.
Thank you so much, Daman. So I think just to get started, right, I think growth marketing has become a buzzword over the last like 18 months or so, especially in the pandemic as well, even on LinkedIn, but you've been at it for the last like 5-6 years, really driving hyperscale for many of the startups. So before we get into the hyperscaling itself, like, was your entrepreneurial background with, Concept Gears and Planet Gogo? Could you share a little bit about the learnings from there, both in the education space and personalized news, and how that kind of came into like your experiences with MobiQuick and Milk Basket? I think that would be a great starting point, Daman.
Sure. So can you guys hear me? Hello?
Yes,
can
Daman,
you guys hear me?
I think the screen's
okay. Frozen, yeah, sure. Yeah. Okay, cool. I think it'll unfreeze in a while.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's interesting you brought up Concept Gears, because that for me was a learning pad. We did everything that could be done wrong when you start up. We had no clue on how to grow and how to do business. We were just figuring out what a sales cycle is. So from that point of view, I think it was a good learning experience for me. And the interesting thing is, when I started on this whole journey to drive growth, I said to myself, I want to be a dhandewala marketeer, wherein I put 1 rupee, I know I'm getting 1.5 rupees back, either now or 5 months down the line. So with that in mind, I discovered this whole realm of metrics and building growth teams, which frankly at that point in time wasn't that prevalent in the Indian market. So it was very interesting initially. I mean, right from being able from buying Google inventory to driving growth, and we did some crazy stuff. We got 3 million app installs in 1 month, and we hardly even spent 10 lakhs on Google. Such things can't be done today, but yeah. Right from the time when we actually started writing code to send notifications out, today we have so many plug and play softwares and marketing automation tools available. So it's been quite a journey to see how to drive growth in the digital platforms. And frankly, I'm still learning every day. I mean, there's a new platform coming up almost every month. We're trying to figure out how to leverage that with and at the same time avoid the shiny object syndrome. You know, kuch naya hai toh achha hai. So trying to avoid that. So yeah, it's been pretty interesting.
Absolutely. I think good, interesting that you brought up, Danda as well. I think that even Aman from Vote, who's one of the founders, I think that's a language I've heard him speak as well, like in terms of not bleeding money. And, you know, I'm sure the investors also love it where they don't see a startup which is burning through millions or billions of dollars before getting cash flow. So is that a philosophy you have held across the other startups as well, like at MobiQuick and, Milkbasket? Obviously, it's quite challenging to be like unit level positive from day one, right? So how do you look at that in terms of lifetime value versus like immediate returns?
So I've kind of been fortunate to work for the underdog all through my life. You know, I've never had a market leader kind of a budget available with me, like a Samsung or a Unilever does. So it helps us to think more. It helps us to sweat the asset far more. And what that kind of entails too is that you develop a spirit of experimentation as a marketeer. So I have this going joke, right? You know, that every TV campaign is a success. I mean, behind a campaign, there's no one in the company who's going to say that it didn't work out. So, but the way we run is we get a bit worried if we don't fail on a weekly basis. And even while working with your teams, I mean, they come up with a new idea. Yeah, I'm always for try the experiment out. Maximum we lose is 10,000 rupees. If we win, we end up putting 10 lakhs behind it and making a crore out of it. So that's kind of the philosophy I've kind of followed with trying to sweat the asset and, you know, get a reasonable CAC match the CAC LTV. So I have this whole funda about the CAC LTV spectrum. A low LTV player can only go for a low CAC. But a high LTV player can go for a higher CAC. So you need to have that product market CAC LTV fit also. Otherwise, you know, you're kind of doomed as a startup. And frankly, there are a lot of business models over there which say, okay, you know, we're going to build the user base right now. We're going to monetize it later. I've been in some of those business models also. Line was such a business model where you circulate, accumulate a huge, insane amount of user base, and then you start monetizing it 3 to 5 years later. So at that time, our guardrails were a certain amount of CAC. And the way I see it, every company has one or two channels which are the star channels for them, right? Quite often what I've seen is a startup activates all the channels together. Business development, Facebook, affiliates, Google, Snapchat. And you end up burning quite a lot of money. I would always say that, you know, start with one or two channels. Okay, try to optimize that. One works, put a person on the job, and then keep experimenting with the next channel and the next channel. So that's what kind of worked for us in the past.
Thank you so much, Daman, for sharing those insights and giving us a good understanding that what startups should do, what they should not be doing when they begin. So just as you come from a very vast experience, you have a lot of experience from different sectors. So just wanted to know, as this session is all about metrics, we talk about all about data. So how has data actually helped you in driving your key decisions for any of your marketing activities? Data is obviously of two types. It could be good or bad. But how have you kind of molded that into making a good strategy for any of your campaigns? Or if you could throw some light on that also for us.
Okay. So while I look at any company, I know there are one or two, data points or metrics that we want to move, right? And unless you have enough telemetry built into the system and the processes, you don't end up getting good data. So for example, if your attribution is not set up correctly, you end up looking at a wrong dashboard and you end up optimizing your campaigns for something else. So from my point of view, I look at two things for data. One is the telemetry that gives me the data, the information. And second is, how much can I trust that? Is there a better way to do it? Because a lot of times I've seen marketers go the wrong way because the data says so. And if I take the whole funnel, if I look at user acquisition, for example, ad fraud plays a huge, huge role in fudging up the data, right? You might attribute a certain acquisition to an affiliate, whereas Google may be getting it to you, right? So that kind of throws the marketer off and puts more money on an affiliate. Second is the way you measure data. You might say, okay, I'm going to go at a last click attribution, or I mean, not do a data-driven attribution. So then you are just discounting anyone who, any of the channel who has actually helped build the brand before the user comes and buys into you. So it's quite a complex problem, you know, in terms of how you want to read the data. So, and I've quite often seen a lot of companies not even put in the right instrumentation to gather the data. So that is one part. And second is taking the easy way out, saying, achha, this is a free tool, let's just use it. Okay, and get on with it. But then it comes to bite you back in the ass when you're planning to grow, because then the cost of change is very high. And second is, you suddenly realize your past data is, you know, it's not relevant. So then what do you do? And at this point in time, you're not spending 10,000 a day, you're spending 10 lakhs a day. So now what do you do, right? So each day that gets delayed, you're ending up spending 10 lakhs wrongly. So for me, I look at these two particular things. The next is creating, data lakes in the organization. Once you have all this data, a marketer needs to be able to visualize this data. Moment a marketer starts going to an analyst and saying, you know, show me what this can do, campaign doesn't run. There's a lot of lethargy that gets built into saying, okay, you know, data aayega, we'll run it after 2 days. So one of the things that we did at MobiQuick was we literally democratized data in the organization. So the marketer can just look at a particular cohort or look at a set, click and run a campaign on that particular cohort. So I think, for a marketer, data is the glue for all that we do. And frankly, we spend very little time learning about it. We spend very little time in understanding how to create meaningful and manageable data. So I think that's something which CMOs need to start very actively looking at.
Yeah, very interesting point, Daman, on visualization. And, you know, I think we've recently also used like Data Studio, Google's Data Studio for some visualization. I think just given your vast experience across, you know, like a company like White Hat Junior, which is EdTech, Milk Basket, which is daily e-commerce, and Boat, which is, you know, infrequent purchases, right? So for these three sectors, maybe not specifically for these companies, but for example, EdTech versus daily e-commerce versus lifestyle e-commerce, how would you see the metrics differ? Like, which metric would you look at for each of these? I think if you could share some light on.
Yeah, sure. So my favorite metric is the North Star metric. What is that metric which describes that the value that your organization delivers to the user? So people a lot of times says revenue is my North Star metric. Revenue is not your North Star metric. Revenue is what your customers give you. Well, North Star metric is what, the price that they pay for what the is. So I kind of look at the North Star metric for a particular company. For example, at Milk Basket, personally, I used to look at number of items delivered on time, right? Which encapsulates number of orders, which encapsulates number of items put in an order, and which also ensured that the delivery happens on time. So this North Star metric kind of brings the whole organization together. So that is a metric. And then, well, this is a very big metric. You start breaking them out into smaller chunks, right? From the point of acquisition, from the point of retention, from the point of discovery of products. So then you start looking at those smaller metrics, and then you start creating growth pods to attack a particular metric. For example, if I want more items in an order, I'll make sure that my search functionality is pretty awesome, or my discovery functionality is pretty awesome, so that people put more and more items into the basket. And I specifically put on time, because if a grocery delivery is not on time, it causes a lot of dissonance, right? So if that comes in, then obviously the repeat order comes in very fast. So then how does, so then there's a growth team which is looking at how do I make sure that my distribution problem is solved in the most efficient way. Should I put 10 trucks to it, or should I put just one truck and make sure that is just service localities and so on and so forth in the most optimal way. So breaking the big North Star metric into smaller metrics, and then putting growth pods to it, right? And growth pod typically is a cross-functional team, right? For example, someone who's doing improving the search functionality of an app, it'll have a techie, it'll have a data analyst, it'll have a marketeer, right? Someone who's handling on time, it'll have the ops folks in it, right? So on and so forth. So that's how I personally look at breaking the North Star into smaller metrics. Specifically at Boat, we are right now looking at several what I called one metric that matters every month. So because we're solving a lot of problems simultaneously, we're trying to optimize a bunch of metrics, which ultimately lead into the North Star metric for us over here.
So like for Boat, what would be the North Star metric, Raman? Like, and would you all also track NPS, for example? Or
so NPS feeds into the North Star metric finally, because NPS is a function of how my whole experience was in ordering and how my product is, right? So it forms a small part of the overall game. And let's talk about NPS a bit. So people a lot of times say that NPS kind of encapsulates how the customer feels and whether they'll come back or not. I'm saying, yeah, that's just a part of it. But if your whole organization doesn't come together to deliver on the customer's expectations, right, in the most efficient manner, then NPS doesn't make that much sense. NPS is kind of a shortcut for us to see how the customer experience is, but it also averages out a lot of stuff which you cannot manage. NPS is more of a heuristic rather than a deterministic metric for me, mm-hmm. right? Because it's a sample based metric. If I look at a deterministic metric saying that the amount of time that a person uses Boat phone when he has to use earphones, that would be ideally something which I would measure, but I can't measure that, right? Again, because I can't enter into this house and put a camera and see how long is using my earphone.
The RP scam is on way, but yeah.
So we are looking at metrics right now, which are getting our organization processes together so that we can service the customer in the most efficient and the best possible way, right? For a company like Boat, coming up with new products also matter a lot. We need to keep pushing the envelope. So it's a bit complex than just putting NPS as a figure, because we launched every time we launch a new product or a new category, we kind of the demand kind of surprises us, right? So there's a lot of latent demand built in. So does that mean we are not efficient in forecasting demand? No, that's not the case, because we are a startup. We're not going to build for far more than what the demand is. Does that mean that we're not understanding the market correctly? Again, that would be something which would be not presumptuous to say, but we are also learning right now to figure out in audio what else are users looking for. So it's a very complex journey for us at this point in time, frankly.
Right. No, definitely. Thanks, Dhawan. You covered both Milk Basket as well as Boat. I think just given your experience with some of the other startups, even like EdTech, for example, people who do demos, like there are so many metrics even in EdTech, right? So how does the organization which is looking to scale 10x in 6 months, how do they decide on that one metric? And does that metric also change over time? Like, when do you decide to... this metric does not make sense, let's shift to another metric.
So that's a pretty awesome question. So the North Star metric remains more or less the same, right? If you're selling products today, it's not like that you're going to be selling SaaS tomorrow, right? So the North Star metric kind of remains the same. Okay, Airbnb is going to sell nights, right? So what changes in terms of focus on a month-to-month, on a quarter-to-quarter is the one metric that matters, right? For example, for the next 30 days, I'm going to focus on how soon can the user check out and get the order delivered, right? The next month, probably I'm going to put more of my personal focus on how do I make sure that when the person is wants the next pair of earphones, he comes back, right? How do I do that? Then probably I can figure out how can I make my product roadmap more robust? How can I upsell and resell? So on and so forth. So the North Star metric remains the same, but the smaller metrics that feed into it, you start looking at that with different focus levels throughout the journey. So the metrics don't change, the focus of the metric, the focus of the metric changes. It's also very important to remember that each metric should also have guardrails. For example, if I want to grow 10x, like you said, right? But if my CAC is going out of the window, then it doesn't make sense. So the CAC becomes the guardrail over here. So if I'm using Google as a channel and I'm doing 3,000 orders with it and I want to go to 30,000 orders, I need to make sure my CAC is not 10x. My CAC can mainly go 1.5x to that extent. So guardrail metrics are also something which we define very clearly, right? Because you incentivize someone to say, get me 10x growth, but you don't put the guardrail, he will show you 10x growth, but at what cost? That's going to drive everyone up the wall. So that's something we look at. The other metric that we always look at is if there is a metric that we're measuring which involves the customer, we also try to figure out how to make sure that the metric is not gamed, right? Given the population that we work with, way in which the metric can be gamed, it just throws the whole ecosystem off. And we used to look at this very carefully in MobiKwik, because the commodity that's being transferred is money, right? Moment you have a pipe with which money can be transferred, it kind of disrupts a lot. A lot of fraud starts coming in. So on and so forth. So those are the kind of things that we kind of keep in mind. Specifically on, if I look at the top end of the metrics, the acquisition metrics, right? We played very carefully with the digital media, right? While it lends itself to measurement, it also lends itself to a lot of mismeasurement. So, that's what we also look at.
Absolutely, Daman. I think very interesting point on the guardrails also. I don't think I've heard that term used earlier, but we obviously used it as a benchmark. Okay, you have to grow, but within this cost constraint. But using that guardrail as a philosophy, I think can definitely guide a lot of young companies to scale sustainably while scaling rapidly, right? So you're not bleeding cash unnecessarily while you scale.
Yep.
Thank you, Daman, for sharing these metrics. I think it gave us great insights in terms of how you plan, how you strategize and all. So since you've spoken a lot about metrics and we know that data is the key and we see how every strategy works with the help of data, we just wanted to understand your thoughts that what do you think is the role of content strategy that comes into place for this? Like how would you marry maybe data and the content strategy together to kind of understand that how would you differentiate it's a good content strategy from a great content strategy in a way. So just wanted to know your thoughts on what would it be for content strategy while marrying it with data for you.
Sure. So the way I look at content is I divide content as per the funnel that the user is in. So there is a lot of, we need to generate a huge amount of top level content. Okay, and then we need to generate a lot of end funnel content, right? For example, let me not take White Hat as an example here. Let me take Boat as an example here. Okay, so we've started a lot of top of the funnel content, in terms of gift ideas for this Diwali, right? And stuff like when you're choosing an earphone, what are the top 10 things that you need to look at and that kind of stuff. Okay, and the way, and then there's a lot of mid-funnel and end-funnel content where we say, what are the 10 things that you need to look at in a earphone? What are the different comparative prices? What are the comparison on features? You know, typically what happens on during an electronics buy. And each content serves a different purpose. So the top of the funnel is more to get into the consideration set of the user. So what we measure is the amount of traffic that it brings onto our website, right? And the time that user spends on our website by virtue of that content. And is that content also lending us to be more searchable in when someone's looking at our category? So it's more about traffic building at that point in time. The mid funnel content and the bottom of the funnel content, which we work a lot with the reviewers, right? They do an awesome job for us in the sense of unboxing, in the sense of describing our chipset, so on and so forth, answering FAQs and that kind of stuff. And for us, what this happens is this translates to how much of the traffic that we are converting is by help of this. Now, this is a bit tricky because obviously I can't put my pixel on every website, right, that these guys are on. So this is a bit of a heuristic that we follow that, okay, you know, we know that we are going to get 20 top-end reviewers to write about our particular Thule wireless earbud. And then we see how this is going to go. And we kind of know now with past data that, you know, we need these many amount of views. We need these many amount of reviews that happen to us. Also on our own YouTube channel, now we started putting a lot of unboxing videos for every new product that comes in, which is something which we're not doing very actively earlier. We were relying on reviewers. So coming back to your original question, there is a metric that we can attach to each one of them. So for example, I know that the more the people watch the unboxing videos, the more sales I'm going to get. So that means people have come that deeper into. So if my top level content is good, I'll end up getting more reviews. I'll end up getting more views on reviews. And then that kind of, you know, leads into sales. So yeah, not very deterministic, but heuristically, it does an awesome job.
No, very interesting, Dhawan. I actually wanted to check if we can share our screen and, you know, run through a few of those examples. And I think, you know, with both, even with IPL, you'll have sponsored a lot of the teams and, you know, I think just wanted to run through a few and then discuss on the metrics of how you measure both of the online influencers and celebrities and the offline as well, you know.
Sure.
He is wearing his helmet with both. How do you measure the metrics for that? Sure. So let me share the screen this one. Starting with this.
Okay, one too many mother lovers be around ya. 6 feet deep, bury them in the ground ya. Sing a eulogy on your grave with my hounds set. Wrong try to count anybody in the love ya.
Really great production quality as well, obviously. I just want to play one influencer video as well.
While fashion and style has always kept me going, my creative expression has come from the things that I'm truly passionate about. My passion and love for music as an incredible art form made my paths cross the boat. A good pair of audio wear has always been a part of our wardrobe essentials, especially when you are part of a young, evolving and contemporary generation. There's no other way it would rather be. So I thought to add the Masaba touch to my favorite boat headsets. And through this collaboration, you see an extension of brand Masaba mixed with the cutting edge audio wear of boat.
Yeah, Great. So I think very, interesting videos, Daman. So, how do you all decide on these celebrities? What metrics do you all look at? And, how do you measure the impact as well in terms of top of the funnel? It'd be great to hear your thoughts on this.
So in board, I think a brand has, influencers have played a huge, huge role in a brand. Right. And I think all kudos to Aman and gang. I mean, they started this journey way before I joined in identifying these particular celebs. So our TG primarily is between 18 to 30. Right. So we've kind of latched on to the key lifestyle happenings of this particular TG. So in India, it's particularly music, cricket, fashion. So these are the key three areas that we kind of focused on. In cricket, you've seen some of the partnerships we've done. We've got four brand ambassadors. We partnered with six teams, and it's interesting that you played the KL Rahul, because we kind of had a hypothesis that one of the other videos would do pretty well, but the organics on KL Rahul just shot through the roof. We were like, okay, now we understand that his fans are far more passionate. Feedback like this gives us a lot more insight into what we need to do. And since we are positioned as a lifestyle brand, early on we felt that partnering with one of the leading fashion destinations in India, which is Lakme Fashion Week, that will really help us build a connect with the audience. And that's gone on year after year. I think this is the third year that we're getting into a partnership with them. We do a lot of limited edition stuff. A lot of our community, they like to collect some of those. It's a pretty awesome place to be in. To have people love the brand so much, that they associate with it. If you see, we work with celebrities in a very different way that a Coke or Pepsi does. Instead of just saying that, buy my product, it's more about how this product fits into my, fits into my character, fits how it fits into my life. And people who associate themselves with that particular celeb, they kind of build a deeper connect with the brand, rather than someone just saying that wear this particular banana or something like that. It's pretty well thought out. In terms of the engagement that we see, so we get a very good sense of what kind of following what kind of interest this particular collaboration has created, and that also helps us a lot into planning our inventories, planning our sales, so on and so forth. Right, so we know that if it's the next 100,000 video view, that we can expect these many people coming onto the platform. Again, that feeds a lot into the backend data. Once they come onto a website, then it's just numbers for us, right? Then we start measuring how many hits have we got to a particular page, how many people have requested for a particular product to go live, so on and so forth. So we can kind of anticipate a lot of this. Similarly, with all the cricket teams that we went live with, right? We've gone live with six. We brought out co-branded inventory. And interestingly, a lot of the cricketers themselves call us up saying that we want this product. So, that kind of tells us, we've hit... So we're creating something meaningful. We're just not tagging on a brand of a partner onto our product. So we've created something which is in sync. And we've seen them use these products on the ground, take the boombox with them, so on and so forth. So that kind of gives us an idea of how well this particular association is working. Music is something obviously we are very close to, and also different genres of music. Like Sunburn is another place that we've been partnering with for quite some time. We see a huge amount of ROI on that. Again, it's a very aspirational brand. The music is very aspirational. We've partnered with Guru Randhawa, Diljit Dosanjh, and a bunch of them. A lot of stuff is going to be happening in the coming days. So this is something which helps us, tap into their communities, and them also identify very well with the brand. So yeah, influencers is going to be a very key strategy for us going forward. And I think that's really helped the brand become quite recognizable today.
So I think like Daman, like one of the challenges in the influencer space, like we also started out with influencer.in like 3-4 years back. I think a lot of brands still compare like, you know, at a CPM level for influencers. So how many people am I reaching? What is the CPM for this? Do you think that's like the right metric to look at, or you know, brandless studies, which you know some of the platforms offer, or would you measure like the search impact in terms of number of people visiting your website after influencer campaign? How would you like decide on, you know, whether the campaign's successful or not?
So, influencers a lot of trial and error, right? You need to figure out what's the right fit. And I think every brand has its journey on that. No one has a set playbook saying that, you know, ye 5 influencers lo and you'll sell 10 crore kamaat. I wish it was like that, but it is not. So in terms of the way we see it, we do not measure how many products we've sold by one Facebook post. Let me put it that way. That is not the measure by which we are going by. But we do know that it creates a rising tide which lifts, pun intended, the boat. So we know that for us to talk to the user, to our TG, we need to have 4 or 5 influencers talking about us at any point in time. So we kind of pace it out on that, right? Now in terms of what kind of ROI we see this more as a awareness to consideration set kind of a thing. So this moment an influencer starts writing about us, we start seeing a bump up in people subscribing to our YouTube channel, people following us on Insta, you know, so on and so forth. And that gives us a whole amount of user base to interact with even further, rather than just doing a paid campaign and getting these guys on board and they just click something because they saw a good photo. So this is something which is content driven. And I think we get a far more ROI that, from an influencer telling us, getting some of his fan followings onto our page, rather than us saying, you know, let's spend 10,000 rupees to get 200 followers. So that's the difference. And you know, moment you start, so for D2C brands, building the community is the holy grail, right? Moment you start building a community which loves your brand, which talks about your brand, right? Everyone becomes an influencer at the end of the day. So it starts from the big influencers. It gets these guys also to talk. So it's also the influencers, role to get other guys in the community to start talking about us. And I think influencers do that very well for us, which for us so influencers like a sales multiplier for us. Let me put it that way.
No, definitely. I think the Boathead community, you know, it's I've seen it a lot online, especially, right? I think a lot of people talking about Boat and, you know, even the reviews and comments. It's really amazing what the company has achieved in a very short period of time. Kudos to you and the team.
Also, I think because of these influencers, and especially I think how we term them as Boatheads, as how we call them, I think they have created a great impact in the market for Boat. And I think that's one of the reasons that Boat is also amongst the top selling products in terms of Amazon and Flipkart, which would be our third party vendors. But obviously, as Daman, you also have a vision here to build Boat more as the number one brand in D2C sector here. So could you share some insights or some thoughts in terms of what are your innovations that you plan to bring about, or what are your strategies to make this as the number one ear brand in India from a D2C point of view?
So see, for us, we know that we're going to live in this ecosystem, right? Marketplaces and D2C are both equally important to us, right? So Flipkart and Amazon, they play a very key role for us, because today around 1/3 of the product searches are happening on these platforms, right? Directly. So we need to be there. We work very closely with them. And I think that's one of the big assets that we have of working very closely with the marketplaces. And then there's our own website also. And it's just not these two marketplaces. We work with a ton of them, right? Obviously in India, these two are the biggest. So from a brand perspective, we need to ensure that we live up to a promise across all the platforms, right? And there is going to be a reason for people to come onto the D2C platform and buy besides the marketplaces also, because just like we do exclusive launches with Flipkart, with Amazon. So today we just did a smartwatch launch with Flipkart. There are going to be exclusive launches also happening on the website. The Boathead community is now going to reside on our website in a big way, right? This is going to be a place where people will interact, they'll get a lot more value, right? Which is not just product value, but much more stuff around that, a sense of community around this website. So, and if you're able to do that, if you're able to pull off that, I think we have a good run then lying in front of us. So think of us as a Nike brand which sells everywhere, but if you want to know more about the story, you want to know more about the brand, you go to the website, you know, to engage more with the brand. So it's going to be something like that, you know, wherein the destination is going to provide users with a lot more content, a lot more sense of belonging as more and more, you know, products get launched and also in the coming days.
No, very interesting, Daman. I think a follow-on question is, you know, when Google has started the start shopping with Google campaign on television, and you know, mm-hmm. obviously seeing the massive success of Amazon and Flipkart, mm-hmm. Google will also obviously want some share of that e-commerce journey. So, from a D2C brand perspective, what is your experience in terms of the percentage of sales which should come directly from a website? Should there be a goal as a business leader saying, okay, X percentage of my sales should come from my platform, or it's okay wherever they go till the revenue is coming to, you know, the brand? How would you?
So each brand has its journey. So some brands have started by selling on their website first. Brand like Boat has created a majority of its sales starting from the marketplaces. So there's no set way in figuring this out, but you can't ignore the marketplaces today. Right, because they have an immense amount of traffic. So here's the fun thing, right? You can make a product, but how do you distribute it? Distribution is always going to be king. So if you have adequate traffic coming onto your website, you can latch onto the next product and the next product and you know, try to get the users to discover and love it. But if you want an easy distribution, you go to the marketplaces. But then, again, the customer data resides with them. So it's, there's a pro and con with every approach. I think there's a lot of middle ground over here in how you want to take this forward. In terms of what percentage of sales should come from D2C, I would say easily, given the Indian market context, in the electronics category, you can easily hit a 20%, 20-25% of sales coming in from your own website. But that also means to be able to pull something off like that at both scale, we really need to grow our infrastructure. So it's going to be a journey for us, right? Because I need to be able to give my users as good an experience as buying from anyone else. So that's, we're making a lot of investments on our operations, on our back end, so on and so forth, you know, so that we can live up to the brand promise.
No, definitely. I think obviously Amazon and Flipkart, even, you know, people shop there frequently. So actually, ideally, your D2C website has to have a better experience or some extra thing, which may not be pricing or anything, but has to have some element why people buy directly, right? Because otherwise, people are so used to buying on Amazon and Flipkart today. Single click, you know, I think some phones and all are getting delivered in 2 hours now, right, by Amazon and Flipkart.
So even we are going to be doing that pretty soon, right? So I mean, also, you know, the whole evolution of infrastructure has become modularized, right? Today, if you want to start an e-com site, you can plug and play a warehouse aggregator, a shipping aggregator, a platform. You know, so you can do a lot of stuff till then you build out your own capability, or if these guys scale up pretty well, there's absolutely no harm continuing with any of them. So, all these things, they take time, and while it's become easy to set up a business, it's become even more difficult to scale it, right? So we live in those strange times, but interesting times.
Yeah, I think as the entry barriers are reduced, it becomes easier to start, but then the competition is intense in most categories, right? Even Boat, like, it's such a competitive category, and it's like if you put it on a paper, it looks very unlikely. The boat journey looks unlikely on paper, right? Like, why would a brand suddenly out of nowhere shoot up as one of the premium brands in the electronic space?
Actually, no, you know, because there was a whole lot of demand, latent demand in the market. They were building pro audio stuff, or they were building bundled audio, right? You buy a phone, you get a earphone. So this market space was quite open until a few years ago. Now, okay, there's a ton of competition around this, but I know the winners are going to win on the back of R&D, on the back of their brand presence. So with every so here's the thing, right? In today's world, a new category is created, but equally swiftly, you have more and more competition coming up because technology is converging on a lot many areas.
Right, Daman. I think just you know, marrying back on metrics, right? Wanted to just spend some time before we open up for the last few questions from the participants as well. Was on how do you build a culture in the team and move those metrics from, you know, what is there with you to the organization and to the team, and how have you done that? Obviously, team drives the success, right? So how?
Yeah. So I've fortunately done that many times over. So it's a three-step process I follow. Is first, let's fix up the measurement. Okay, once we've done that, we baseline, right? One moment we baseline, we know where we are, and we have a target, so we know where we want to go. Okay, and then to bring the data-driven culture, it's pretty simple. So I mean, right now it's work from home, but when I'm in the office, we have a whiteboard in the office which has every key metric that we're tracking open to everyone in the office, right? So there's absolutely nowhere to hide. If you're doing good on a particular day or on a particular week, it's written out there, okay? And that's what I call democratizing of data. Moment I get into any business or I start running a thing, we publish all our data every day. So that kind of keeps far more people viewing that data, and it's quite counterintuitive, because a lot of people say, we'll do monthly closing, and you know, we will tell you at the end of quarter how we are doing. I said no, we'll do daily closing, and we'll tell you exactly where we screwed up during the day and where we need help. You know, so I think that helps us a lot. In fact, we publish our online data to the management every day, so that if there's any idea and if they see us faltering in any way, there's always someone to help us. And if you're doing great, there's always someone in the organization saying that, you know, what the heck did you guys do? So and how can we copy that? So that's pretty much, you know, what we do. Just make everything transparent and open, and measure everything, in the right way.
Thank you so much, Daman. So we also have some questions from the audience right now. So Mr. Himanshu has asked a question here. His question is, with respect to the metrics, a lot of times where we are measuring changes, and what are we measuring changes? So he wants to understand that what are the different kind of measurement methods or attribution models or methods that you use, and how do you decide on the numbers by putting the North Star metrics to it? So how do you attach it to your old data which you have, and how do you attach your North Star metric to that?
Okay, so I think there are 2-3 questions in that. So the first one I remembered was attribution. So there are a lot of attribution models, and I've written a lot of that on my blog also. So figure out what works best for you. Fortunately, today in Google Analytics, you can actually compare one measurement model to the other. So, but don't stress too much about this right up front, because a lot of mistakes that happen is also because there is very less data and people trying to over-index on that. When you're starting out, right, you don't have enough data points to measure. So wait for you. So in the initial days, just do your thing and, you know, work to get the data. But once you start getting scale, then you need to get your attribution model pat. Okay. And there are multiple methodologies available there in the market. They're data-driven. There's this first click, last click, non-direct, so on and so forth. In terms of the North Star metric, I think this is a very interesting exercise, and every startup and every company should do this, wherein you get all the senior leaders in and you say, what is the one metric that will encapsulate the value that we deliver to our user. You know, once you figure that out, and then you start breaking that into smaller metrics, and then everything is pretty clear, right, in terms of where you're going as an organization and which areas need help and which areas are doing pretty well. So for me personally, I go after the most difficult metric that needs a solution. So for example, these days I personally am working on conversion rate optimization once the user does add to cart. So it's just me and my tech team who sit every morning trying to solve how to do that, right? While to a certain extent, we figured out how we're going to get users onto the platform. We figured out once the order is placed, how we're going to service that whole thing. So now we're trying to, so I think as a business leader, you need to go at the most difficult part of the problem and put a process on it, then start giving it off to your team leaders to start managing that. In terms of measurement, so measurement will not change, rather, right? You know, your measurement will, let me put it, you may get a better system to measure stuff, but you'll essentially be measuring the same thing. If a measurement changes, means you were not measuring stuff the right way to start with. Okay. I mean, there's only one way to measure revenue, right? By the amount of money that's coming into your bank. If you're counting revenue without discounts, so then you're doing something wrong, right? So it's that whole GMV versus net revenue conundrum. Measurement, knowing what to measure is easy. How to measure it is kind of difficult in a lot of areas. For example, what particular ad drove my user to buy? That's a difficult question to answer, right? But which delivery partner delivered the package to the user is pretty easy, right? And in how much time it delivered is pretty easy, right? In today's world. So I get what you're saying. You know, you want to ask how you're measuring what, how much an influencer delivers value to you. Again, for those you need to measure heuristically, not in a deterministic manner.
Sure, Daman. Thank you so much for answering that, Daman. We have one more question from actually Tushar, and it is quite relevant to, as we've spoken a lot about metrics, we've spoken about a lot about data and how metrics and data actually helps us in the consumer funnel. So Tushar has asked that, do you think that data becomes old? Like, because we have a very long consumer funnel, we have a lot of data. So do you think there is like a timeline or a lifetime data that there's some duration attached to data, or is it?
Okay, so here's the interesting thing, right? It depends on what data you need. So data, you use data to make a business decision, right? If there's a user that did something 2 years ago, is that going to help you make a business decision today? If yes, then keep the data. If not, then you know, keep rejigging. For example, I keep the funnel data in my organization just for 6 months. Right, because in 6 months I probably have changed the underlying tech, the user behavior has changed, I've changed my my funnel flow. So indexing over a past metric which is more than 6 months doesn't make sense to me. However, if I want to keep personal information data of a customer, I would like to keep that forever, right? Because he's transacted with me, probably he might want to come back, I might want to give him a specific offer, right? So that data I would want it to be eternal. Cookie data, I would not want it more than 30 days, right? Retargeted data, I don't want it more than another 15 days. So it depends on what level of data that you're looking at. And it's a very good question, because a lot of time we just fill up our databases using crap data, right? We keep endless log files, someone may ask us for it. Unless you are in a regulated environment, in the fintech area, I don't think you need to keep 3 years of data into your. You need to keep transaction data, because obviously that's proprietary to you, and you know, and that's useful for accounts and finance. But other than that, in terms of visitor data, data which helps you to market, more than 6 months. Since most of the folks on the forum are in from marketing, more than 6 months of Purana data, it's not going to help you in any way. Right, the users probably bought a competition product and moved on, or he's bought your product. So what are you going to do with it?
Thanks a lot, Dhawan. I think one thing I personally can take away is, you know, from your session and talking to you is you love what you do, and that's where the passion and, you know, the energy comes, and you spread that to others as well. You spread it to our colleagues who work with you, and, you know, it's the passion and energy to always go for the best, but, you know, experiment as well. So I think your openness to experimentation, as you said, you know, invest 10,000 rupees, you might lose it, but if it works out, then you can make it a crore by investing 10 lakhs on a campaign. I think those are very interesting points. Thank you so much for taking out the time. I think lots of other questions as well. I think one of the participants felt he didn't answer his question as well. I think we'll just end with that. And, you know, any closing remarks from you? I think that's a young startup. Udaya was asking, he's currently spending around 1.5-2 lakhs on ads and getting 7 lakhs of sales. So he's getting a 3.5 ROAS on his campaigns. Is that fine? Or, you know, what do you suggest for a young startup?
Yeah,
like,
I mean,
that?
3 to 4 ROAS, close to 4 ROAS is brilliant. I mean, that's the space we all want to be in.
Absolutely. No, great, Dhaman. Any closing remarks for the audience? Anything you'd like to share with you know, us this afternoon?
Nothing. Yeah. I mean, thanks for having me over. And if you guys have any question, I'm there on LinkedIn. Just feel free. I love to solve marketing problems. So in case I can help you in any way, do feel free to reach out to me. I'll be more than happy to spend half an hour or 1 hour with you guys on the weekend.
I forgot to mention, actually, you have a wonderful blog as well, right? Dhamansoni.com.
Dhamansoni.com. Yeah, I write a lot of stuff over there. It was primarily so that I don't forget all my ideas. So, but it's kind of taken life of its own. So, yeah, a lot of stuff that I've spoken here, it's pretty much there, yeah, on that blog.
I think very interesting topics and in-depth. I think you spoke about social proof in one of your blogs. I think fascinating to see all the examples which you shared, you know, I think.
Yeah, so basically the most high traffic over there is zero-cost marketing. that's the one that gets the most hits. Yeah, and I tell that to a lot of people. You don't need a lot of money to market. Initially, there's a lot of stuff that can be done for your cost.
Very inspiring, and, you know, for a lot of our entrepreneurs and, you know, startups here as well, I think that's going to be a good sign that, okay, you don't need millions of dollars to crack it. So I think thank you so much, Dhaman, again.
Thanks, guys. Thank you. Thanks for having me over. Bye-bye.
Hand it over to Rachna now for our next session with Dr. Banker and Dhruvi as well.
Okay. See you guys.
Thank you, Dhaman.
Bye.
Firstly, immense gratitude to Social Beat for giving me the opportunity to moderate this session. Dr. Banker, it means three H's, which is a man of heart, hard work, and humility. So I'm very, very happy to be hosting Dr. Banker today. So Dr. Banker, we'll start, after your formal introduction, I guess we'll deep dive into the topic, which is about how you have basically scaled up the IVF business using digital. And then we'll keep, the session open to questions. Our session is going to be fairly conversational. And I'm, I would just like to tell Dr. Banker, I know that he's always time crunched. And when you have a doctor here, it's always about a matter of lives. And with him, it is more about matter of bringing new lives into this world and bringing joy into families. So I shall just begin with formally introducing Dr. Banker. So Dr. Manish Banker is one of the renowned fertility experts in India. He holds the prestigious position of medical director at Anova IVF Fertility, one of India's largest groups of IVF specialty hospitals. Starting way back in 1989, Dr. Banker has been one of the pioneers of IVF treatments in India, right? So he has been all over the world, like Germany and Australia, and gotten the best practices from there to establish his IVF practice in India. Well, the achievements of Dr. Banker are far and wide. He is the recipient of the prestigious DC Roy National Award. He has been the president of the Indian Society for Assisted Reproduction, a member of the draft committee for Art Bill of India, and the experts cum monitoring committee for National Registry of Art Clinics and Bank in India. He is a regional representative for the International Committee for Monitoring Art, a non-state actor in an official relationship with the World Health Organization. The course director and a PG teacher for the two-year fellowship in reproductive medicine offered by the National Board of Examinations. I can just go on and on for Dr. Banker, but I guess I'll stop here. Welcome, Dr. Banker.
Thank you very much, Ratna. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for having me.
We're so happy. So, Doctor, even before I start diving into the topic, I would like to know, how do you seamlessly manage being a doctor and running the business?
I think this is the Gujarati blood running in me more than anything else.
Right.
But I think if you are passionate about your work, I think you would also spend time in spreading awareness and seeing to it that you are able to offer it to more and more number of patients. So maybe not from purely a business perspective, but even if you want, if you're passionate, you would always want it to grow and maybe reach out to more and more people. So, I mean, in a sense, it's an extension of what you believe in, and that is what you would always like to do.
That's fabulous, sir. Well, getting started on the topic itself, my first question would be to you, how do you see patient acquisition change for you over the years in this industry? You've been here from 1989. So how do you see that has changed, and how do you now go about acquiring your customers?
I think traditionally medical practice was always a kind of word of mouth. You go and get treated by a particular doctor. While you are admitted or you're undergoing a procedure, your relatives and your friends come to see you. They like the entire experience. You also talk to about this to your friends. And that is how your reputation spread. So it was predominantly a kind of word of mouth. I think in the medical field, advertisement was so-called a taboo when we actually started practice. Then came the era of super specialists. And super specialists actually depended on the general doctors to refer patients to you. So we had a second stream coming up, which was a doctor-referred patient, because he was not offering that specialized treatment. And he would refer a patient who needs such specialized treatment to such super specialists. So these two were and will still be the predominant sources of patients in any medical practitioner. But what has changed now is that every patient who gets to know about you through either of these two sources would always go on the net and do a search. Because today it is so easy for everyone to search for a person or a treatment or anything that for a kind of a reinforcement, they will always search. And there is always a possibility that someone who has been referred to you finds another person on the digital platform whom he or she feels is more suitable to your needs. And you might actually end up losing a patient who needs the treatment, who has been referred to you, but simply goes to someone else because that person is more active. So digital in that sense is an extremely important reinforcement media. You need good word of mouth, you need good doctor referral base. But this forms a very strong reinforcement for increasing your practice today.
Right. Would really like to know how digital has helped your business, particularly what are the things that you have done, to grow your business from the digital medium?
So two other things have changed in the current times. One is that the reach of the medical practitioner has become, almost limitless. Today, it will not be surprising that you would find patients traveling a few hundred kilometers if they know that they are going to get the right treatment. So in that sense, this is something which can only be spread through the digital media. You cannot have physical presence in all distant locations. So digital primarily helps you in spreading your reach to beyond the conventional boundaries. Second, what I feel the digital media helps you is in kind of positioning where you are. Because every doctor would say that I am offering the same kind of treatment, but it is very important is how you position yourself within that particular treatment space. And this is where digital media plays an immense role, because it is actually a reflection of what you are for the general public. So very careful in how you design your digital platforms, what kind of messaging you do, what kind of information you would like to give out. Are you a simple service provider? Are you the cheapest service provider? Are you the most technologically advanced player? Are you the most cost-effective player? So it is very important how you position yourself. And for this, you need to take the help of all the digital platforms. Blogs and something help in a sense for creating brand positioning. You can create treatment videos on YouTube where you can actually showcase what kind of treatments you are offering. You can use this for patient education, because again, positioning yourself as a thought leader or someone who is providing education, again, puts you in a completely different league. So you can use different platforms for promoting different images or different messages, but everything centered around what you want people to perceive you as. I think that is the crux. You first need to define as to how would you like your patients to see you? How would you like your referring doctors to see you? And then you design the entire campaign, whether it's on Facebook, whether it's on Instagram, whether it's on YouTube, whether it's a direct Google advertisement, everything then has to revolve around this.
Sure. So typically, the patients who, how do you see the patient coming from an online lead versus the patient who's coming through a referral? Do you see any difference in the in their characteristics per se, in the way they are, the personas?
Yes and no. Because today what is happening is that it is very difficult. Very few patients come from a single source. So even if you have a doctor referred patient, before he steps into your clinic, he would have searched you on the net. It is practically impossible that any patient just walks into your clinic without looking at the net on you. So they will know more things about you than you would have thought of. And maybe at the end of the consultation, they will tell you, yes, this is exactly what I'd seen and what I'd expected. So in one sense, digital media sets expectations in patients' minds. And it is very important that you meet these expectations. So the patients are essentially the same, but someone who has come through the digital field comes with a set mind because he has seen you delivering some things and he has come expecting certain things from you. So in that sense, you have to be more careful in handling them. They need much more attention and they are very, very tough taskmasters.
Right. So the digital consumer is basically more aware, rather.
Well aware.
Yeah. He's completely there, then he's come to you. So if you were to look at a time when you did not use digital marketing versus now that you're using digital marketing, in terms of the quantum of business, right, how much do you think it has really grown?
So as I said, it is difficult to pinpoint the increase only to this, because this will always be a reinforcing medium. But I do see business coming through this, either purely or this, contributing to at least 25-30% of my business, which was practically nil when we started this off maybe 6 months. When did we start? Sometime in March, April, I think.
Yes. It was
a long time period which we actually used.
Right.
So at least now I have 25-30% of my patients who would have seen me on the digital platform before they walk into the meeting. The other place where this really helps is in follow-ups. Because whenever a patient visits you and you know that this patient is not clear about maybe a thing X or Y, you could send them digital links on what you have prepared for that particular question. So you can actually do a targeted the information giving to that particular patient. For example, for us, a patient might be sensitive only on what will be my pregnancy rate. And you cannot explain everything when the patient is in the clinic. So maybe sending specific videos or links, it gives the patient time to go through this. And more importantly, they can view this with their entire family around. So maybe this also helps us in influencing the family to make them come to us. So it has a huge impact, sometimes not very, very directly tangible, but it does play on their mind.
Yeah. During the pandemic, at least the lockdown period, we saw that even the hospitals and the doctors, and especially in your case where the new patients first come through in consultation. So it's not an emergency. So people kind of postpone visiting, an IVF specialist because it's not the necessity of the hour. So during the pandemic, how did you go about your patient consultation, and what were the steps you took to ensure, that business somewhere balances out, in the coming months?
So as you rightly said, IVF is not an emergency treatment. So what happened with the introduction of the lockdown is we practically shut down, because all professional societies came out with guidelines that we do not know how the COVID situation affects a pregnancy. So the entire month of April was practically zero. Then we started getting more and more information that this virus does not affect a pregnancy. And we slowly started up. And the entire initial communication was through digital. It was either a WhatsApp call or a Zoom call. And most of the consultations happened on phone or on the digital platform. And once the patient started gaining confidence, they came to the clinic, but very, very restricted clinics, very, very targeted visits. The predominant part of the consultation treatment happened remotely. So we gradually started building up. And now we are practically at about 80-90% of our pre-COVID business, because now people have accepted that pregnancy and COVID are not completely opposite. I mean, they can definitely go hand in hand.
Sure. The other thing that comes to my mind is, Doctor, Gujarat, being a Gujarati myself, I know we are very language and culture specific, right? And a lot of online communication generally for any business, especially in the medical field, goes about in English, right? Yeah. So I would like to understand, what really your target geography is, and how do you manage this, basic issue? Because culturally, as Gujaratis are more comfortable talking in their language, perhaps. Yeah.
I think this is important. So what we have done is, whatever we prepare on YouTube, we always make it in three languages. Everything is in English, Hindi, and Gujarati. The process of shooting, we do everything thrice, because we need the entire content in all the three languages. Certain things in English, pictorial, they might understand, but unless they hear the whole thing in Gujarati, especially when they go home, sit with their parents, who are much more traditional one than what the current generation is, it is very critical that the communication is in the mother tongue. I always believe you can communicate so much easier. Plus, the patients feel comfortable. They know that this doctor is from your region or whatever it is, and maybe he'll be able to understand me better. They are able to relate to you better if they can see and hear you speak in the same language that they can understand. It is very critical that even though predominant content is in English, at least the relevant content has to be in the regional language. It takes that much more time and effort, but I think it is worth it.
Sure. So obviously on your social media, you are going out and about with vernacular communication, right?
Yes.
Right. Also, Doctor, in terms of Europe, part of this huge medical community, you have a standing and all of that. So how basically did this community, how did y'all keep in touch during, the pandemic? How were y'all engaging to understand how to move ahead with COVID?
Actually, it has been a huge blessing in disguise. I mean, previously we used to spend practically 50% of our weekends moving around cities, talking at conferences, meeting people. This whole concept of Zoom or this digital conferences has made life so much easier, where the communication can happen more frequently, more effectively, and much more regularly, sitting in the comfort of your rooms. So I think this has been a huge, huge benefit. Plus, your audience is now no longer restricted to that particular city. Every meeting is practically worldwide. So anyone who is interested can definitely join it. And you can always record and put the content on a digital platform for our viewers to view even at a later stage. So I think from a knowledge sharing and spreading perspective, this is amazing. And I really wonder why we did not catch up on this so much earlier. It was just there for everyone to grab it. But this is superb. This is so much amazing. I think the reach is phenomenal. And one most critical thing, all digital conferences start on time and end on time. That is the biggest plus point. So there are no stretches. It will start on time and it will end on time.
Right. And the cut in the travel is just amazing. I think a lot of us in the business do believe that it's somewhere there is some positive to the COVID. We don't have to be on planes every week.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. So, doctor, some of these newer treatments, at least I think to a country like India, like egg freezing, for example, right? All of it. So do you have any plans of, you know, how you are going to go about market? Because you have, first of all, there is a, you know, a knowledge base required because it's not so prevalent.
I think
this
is where I think the digital platform will play a huge role, because this is a very, very niche market. And you need to spread this awareness across boundaries, because you will have patients across the country who would need them. And right. They go to the places where they have the best possible chance. For example, recently we delivered a Xavier sibling who, a child created to help a sibling who had a thalassemia major. And we did the IVF with proper matching to have a child who will act as a bone marrow donor. Now, this kind of treatment will never be available in every nook and corner of the city. But there is a huge demand. So this is where spreading awareness and positioning yourself as a place or a clinic which is going to offer these treatments, the potential is immense. And this is where I think this can only happen through the digital platform. There is no other way that you can spread both the awareness and your brand.
Sure. So doctor, would you then say that, you know, perhaps, building a thought leadership and brand building is perhaps the first step that someone needs to take when they're trying to move their hospital or clinic business online versus directly going into the path of customer acquisition?
I fully agree with this. Because see, there are two parts to this. One is trying to build this brand awareness or who you are. And second is then actually spending money to get patients. The second part is the easier part. And I think you can have competitors who may want to spend more there. Because then it's a direct question of how much you spend and how much you get. But the more difficult and the challenging part is to build who you are. And that will have a much longer lasting image than the second part. You might then decide to decrease your spends if your awareness is good, if your brand is positioned well. Then what you require is just a presence. You need not enter into this rat race of spending more and more money. But so I always believe that the beginning has to be with deciding who you are, what do you stand for, create a platform which then reflects yourself to your customers, and then start the entire exercise.
What would you think for you has been a platform that you would focus more on? You know, would it be Facebook? Would it be Google? Anything else that you would think from your experience in the last couple of months?
I think for me, in terms of patient acquisition, Google has been far more successful than all the other platforms. But in terms of positioning, I think Facebook and YouTube both have been equally good, because you can put your content, you can put your videos. So from positioning perspective, the other media are equally good. But from a direct patient acquisition, Google has been far more successful than the other platforms.
Sure, doctor. In terms of, any advice to, that you would have for some a doctor or specialist, obviously in the last couple of years with Noah itself, I think Noah was first digital or perhaps 5-6 years ago. So, you know, you have had that experience. But if there is a doctor who is just jumping into the digital realm to get leads, right? Always there is an overwhelming sense of, I would say, you know, my job is to be a doctor and look after the patients, right? And this is going to take a lot of my time. So what would you advise? How would you ask them to manage and prioritize, when they are moving digital?
So as you write, our specialty is medical practice. So the first thing that you need to do is find a partner who knows the digital space. Then sit with the partner and devise a strategy, not a short term, but something which is going to last for the next 2, 3, 4 years. And based on the strategy, help your digital partner to design the contents. It is not a one-time process. It is not a knee-jerk reaction to anything. So you need to find someone who understands you well, understands the subject well, because even for a digital, what the whole medical treatment means, what is our patient base, what are they going to look for, and then take small steps. Don't really stretch yourself. Take small steps, learn from your mistakes, improvise, adapt, and then keep on growing.
Sure, doctor, that is quite insightful, really. I think now I leave, anybody who has any questions can put that on the chat and we can have Dr. Banker answer those. Yeah, so doctor, one of the things while, we get any questions from there, I would like to know, how do you see your return on investment going for you in the last couple of months that you've become strongly, digital?
Honestly, we're still working on it, but but I think return on investment somewhere between 2 to 3x is the minimum that one should expect and one would get. Because that is the minimum that this kind of platform would definitely give us. But the potential to get a much higher return is still there. I think, again, it is a question of fine-tuning your messaging in terms of geographies, in terms of content, in terms of your audience. So the more time you spend and the more specific you get, your returns will keep on increasing. But I would be happy if I get anything above 3x. That would be a good thing to begin with.
Sure. Thank you, doctor. So how do you see, the transformation in the digital transformation in healthcare itself happening really across the medical field?
So the one challenge that the medical field faces in the area of teleconsultation is the medico-legal responsibilities. Because traditionally, you would always see a patient, you would examine the patient and then give treatment or advice. When you do the same thing through a teleconsult, you cannot be that accurate. There are definitely limitations to this. And it is only recently that after the declaration of this pandemic and when the Disaster Act was put into place, doctors have been given medico-legal protection if anything goes wrong on a teleconsult. But previously, doctors were not allowed or they were actually directed not to do a teleconsultation. So that is something which has actually changed, that we now have the legal protection of giving a telephonic consultation. So that is something we will need very strong legal backing, that should anything go wrong on a teleconsultation, because it can never be as effective as a first-hand examination. So that is one thing that we need. Second is to promote the concept that you need to pay a doctor even if you're talking to the doctor on phone. Because traditionally in India, if a patient has a complaint, you would just pick up the phone, ask the doctor, and that is it. Now, when you ask them that, okay, we will give you the advice, but you need to pay for it too. This is also something patients are finding difficult to digest. So we need to change these two scenarios. But I think it will be a win-win situation, because for everything and anything, you don't need a patient to walk into your clinic.
Right. Doctor, how do you see platforms like Practo, Mfine, gaining importance in the present times? So,
I'm a bit skeptical on those platforms, because again, these are predominantly driven through how much money you want to spend. So a kind of a loyalty base is difficult to create on this. Today, you might be the number one customer. Tomorrow, if someone else pays, you are removed from that space. So, I mean, it does help, but I am a bit skeptical on those. I would rather prefer to build my own brand on my platforms rather than be dependent on someone else. I think it is something which has happened to the other business players on Amazon and Flipkart, that you lose your identity and then you are governed by that particular platform. So the same thing can happen if you're too dependent on such platforms.
Yeah, truly agree. Even in the product space, we see that, brands today, especially in the COVID times, are really even, a lot of brands who used to sell through aggregators have gone about building their own websites. and trying to create their own brand name, and even doing direct sales, because that's one way of building credibility, right? Is to create your own brand in itself. And I would agree with you on that. Although it's always important also to be a part of the aggregators, because these platforms then become a medium of search, right?
We cannot ignore them, but we should not be overly dependent on them. That is the only thing. I mean, ultimately, end of the day, the best thing is to communicate with your customers directly.
Yeah. We have one question from the audience, which is, when did you first know that it was a good time to have a digital presence?
I think the whole idea started 5 years back, but it was only during the COVID time when we had nothing else to do that I actually started applying my mind to this. So very actively into this field only from the month of March. But I think it was always there. It was only a question of finding the right, the time, the mindset, and the partner.
Sure, doctor. Thank you. Just looking for... I have one more question from the audience. What do you think about patients' behavior, doctor? Are they comfortable being online and today?
Actually, in my field, yes, because IVF is an extremely personal space. So sometimes patients are more comfortable if they're talking to you one-to-one rather than walking into the clinic and taking opinions. Second, as I said, because this is beyond geography, so patients talking from other cities rather than coming into your city, taking all the efforts, trouble, and the fear of COVID, actually, they're extremely happy doing a primary consult on a digital player, either a phone or a WhatsApp video or whatever it is. So yes, for my field, this is good. But the problem for me is to advise them without examining them. That is the challenge. So again, by and large, the advice would be, yes, this is the possible treatment option. Best that you drop into the clinic once. Because unless you examine the patient, you will never be able to give the correct advice.
Sure. How about smaller towns, which I would call like the next billion audience of Google, right? And I in Gujarat, how do you see the smaller towns or town audiences behave, digitally?
It is still significantly less than the cities, but it is increasing. Probably it's only a matter of time that they will be more savvy to this. But again, this is where I think regional content will be extremely important, because there you need to be in their regional vernacular language. You talk to someone sitting in a small district or a village in English, I think you wouldn't be making sense there. So again, very important that you reach out to this patient in a language that they can understand.
Also, that brings me to an interesting topic about, you know, the blogs or the content that you put across, right? So being a medical field, some of the technicalities are too technical, right? And then we are targeting audiences which a layman. So what do you think is the combination to go with, you know, that communication to go with, so we ensure that he gets it, right?
I think one is to try to make it pictorial, so that at least images they'll be able to understand. And secondly, if you're able to find someone who can translate a good English content into other languages without losing the context, that is the biggest challenge, because you have people who can translate, but you need to translate the medical text without losing the essence. And that is a big, big challenge today. But if you're able to achieve that, nothing better than that.
Right. So we have one more question, and it's quite in line with what I just asked you. It is, how do you think healthcare brands should create content? Like, what should be the starting point, really?
So as I said, the starting point is for the person in charge to decide what he or she wants to communicate, and maybe prepare a kind of a bullet point of what the messaging should be. Then we need someone who will put the actual text, and then someone from the creative side who puts it in a fashion which will be more attractive to your customer. So we need the broader content, someone then tying the nuts and bolts, and then someone putting it in a format which is more attractive to the viewers. It has to be a combination of all three. And then if you're able to translate it across languages, that would be the icing on the cake.
Right. Right. So, you know, the one thing with translation is, I think, is also localization, right? The content just cannot be translated. It has to be culturally relatable to the people that we're translating it to as well.
Right.
So I'm just looking for more questions, if there are any from the audiences. Right. Well, I guess, right. So there's one more question. It says, how do you think, what are the key metrics that you would measure to, basically decide if you're doing well or not on a digital campaign? What would you measure?
So the most important metrics is ultimately how much revenue have you generated through the campaign. And for me, that means how many patients ultimately ended up having treatment with you. That is the absolute bottom line. But there are a lot of intermediate filters that we need to see. First is what has been the reach of your campaign. How many of those patients actually contacted you, either telephonically or through email or whatever? How many of those actually came into your clinic? So that is the first step of conversion. Did you put them off through your initial interaction, or did they find you, attractive enough to walk into the clinic? And once they walked into the clinic, did they actually then end up having treatment with you? So we need to monitor the entire funnel, right from the reach to the actual patients who ended up having treatment with you.
Right. So there is a certain mechanism that you follow to kind of vet these online leads.
Yes.
Do you have a call center
So all the calls or leads are monitored. They are also followed up. And we also track as to when did they walk into the clinic? What is the lag time between an initial call and the patient walking into the clinic? And then once the patient walks into the clinic and has been advised a particular treatment, when and did the patient then have that particular treatment also done? So all these things are very, very meticulously tracked. There is always a 2 to 3 month window, because every patient will not start the treatment immediately on the same day. So we track everything for 3 months, maximum up to 6 months. After that, then we don't track the patient.
Yeah. Doctor, one more interesting platform is WhatsApp. Do you see that getting utilized a lot, in your field?
It is being utilized, but it is primarily for asking questions or immediate concerns, not for consults. It is generally, I reserve it for patients who are under your treatment and they want to discuss certain problems. They can put in a message and then you can reply at your leisure, because if it's an emergency, they need to call and talk to you. But if it is more generic, something which is not very, very critical, it's a good way of exchanging information. The only problem is that the expectations are so high that if you don't reply to a WhatsApp within a certain set of period of time, they get jittery. But everyone needs to understand that you are always busy doing your primary work and you are not expected to reply to a WhatsApp within a set frame. So maybe 24-hour turnaround time should be good enough.
Sure, doctor. The other thing is, since IVF is such a sensitive topic, right? Do you have communication that is specifically for women there, right? So how do you advise on audience segmentation? I know you would say there are men as well, because you look into male fertility as well. But what would be your, advice on how one should go about segmenting that audience? Because it's such a sensitive topic.
Which is, I think we have discussed a few times, how do we decide our segments? And I believe that even though in India, still women are considered to be the more responsible of the two partners for infertility, it is not so. Men are equally responsible. So your campaign has to be directed towards both. This is again the issue of projecting yourself as a thought leader, that infertility is not a women problem, it's a couple problem. This is something which has to go in very strongly. So all your campaigns need to be designed towards the couple. In many couples, it is still the man who is the decision maker.
Right.
Though it is the wife who is affected. And to our surprise, what we found that sometimes it is neither the husband nor the wife, but it is the mother-in-law who is the decision maker.
Right.
So I think you need to go beyond this and maybe not be too narrow-minded in defining your target audience. Give out the content. Probably whoever needs it will actually catch it up.
Sure, doctor. I have a question, one more question. It is just before the pandemic, which was happening, consultation for you, digital or across the table? So I guess the audience is asking, what did you do more? Did you do a lot of face-to-face consultation more?
Predominantly face. I think before the digital, before the pandemic, teleconsultation was primarily for patients from abroad. Otherwise, anyone in India, it was always a face-to-face.
Right. Sure. I think we have a couple of more. So one very, interesting rather question is that, culturally we see doctors as being the god, right? Post-COVID, do you see that that respect has increased far more?
It has. But people have also... that particular respect has definitely increased, especially when I see young doctors who are working in COVID facilities tirelessly. And I know plenty because both my sons are into the medical field. They've been working without any weekly offs for the last 4 months. So they are really working tirelessly. And there is a sense of gratitude amongst the population. You could see that there are more doctors affected by COVID than in the general population. So they have earned that particular respect. Definitely, it has gone up.
Right. I'm just looking for more questions there. Right. Sure. I guess that's about it. Doctor, for me, the respect to you is immense, as I would say. You have coming here, I know how much hard you work, and always it is the matter of lives when it comes to doctors, and you have decided to spend that time with us. So thank you so much. Thank you for the lovely audience and the questions as well. We'll now take a short break and be back at 4 p.m. Right? Right, sure. And after this session at 4 p.m., we would have a session with Amit Singh. Amit, who will be the head of marketing, who is the head of marketing at Rapido. So, yeah.
Thank you very much.
I would, thank you so much, doctor.
Thank you.